Merry Christmas. How you guys doing? Which one of you was dreaming of a white Christmas? Because it looks like we might have got it. Makes you want to sing, I'm dreaming. Well, I just have a couple of announcements this morning to spike out, as we say at work, to you guys. Christmas Eve services are happening. They are, pardon me, 6 and 8 p.m. candlelight service. I think there'll be some slight modifications and some instructions on how to extinguish candles at that time, but I'm pretty sure they don't want you to go, I won't do it. Don't forget, the cards are still out there. I made a big press for that last week. That's a wonderful outreach and a ministry. The funds go towards Uganda. I know Mrs. Lloyd has been busy writing cards and sending them to the ladies in the home. Those addresses, I think, are still in your bulletin, so please don't forget them. Because while we're shut in and with loved ones, they are often shut in by themselves. Last thing, Christmas project, the tree is still out there. There's still envelopes hanging on it. Again, a reminder that goes towards the GEM Foundation, which is a project near and dear to Keith and Vicky's heart for special needs kids in Uganda. And then also close to home, Rainbow's End is also a beneficiary of that. Last thing is sort of a public service, sort of COVID announcement, the mailboxes. If you haven't used your mailbox yet today, just stay in your pews and wait so we can keep our distance. I actually did a little research. I guess you guys have all heard, like, the cases keep going up and up. Cumberland County has about 250,000 people. So just imagine that. That's who's catching it per day. So we thank you for the doctors that have got the vaccine out there, and we pray that that is safe and effective and will change our lives for the good. Last week I read about George Washington. I thought today's sermon's going to be about sight, and I like poetry. I'm weird like that. To woo my wife, sometimes I write her poetry. It's cheesy, just like you'd expect it to be from me. But I found a poet can also create a word vision of something. And I found a poem by Christina Georgina Rossetti, and she's the in the bleak midwinter lady. This isn't quite as bleak. But here's a poem about Christmas. It's called Before the Paling of the Stars. Before the paling of the stars, before the winter morn, before the earliest cock crow, Jesus Christ was born. Born in a stable, cradled in a manger, in a world his hands had made, born a stranger. Priest and king lay fast asleep in Jerusalem. Young and old lay fast asleep in crowded Bethlehem. Satan, angel, ox and ass kept a watch together before the Christmas daybreak. In the winter weather, Jesus on his mother's breast, in the stable cold, spotless Lamb of God was he, shepherd of the fold. Let us kneel with Mary Maid, with Joseph bent and hoary, with saint and angel, ox and ass, to hail the King of Glory. Hope you liked it. I think Mr. Knode's up next, and he's gonna light our Advent candle.
On this fourth Sunday of Advent, I'd like to read from Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2, and then verses 6 and 7. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. As we light these candles of Advent in anticipation and hope of the celebration of the birth of Christ and the light that he brings into the world, I'm reminded of a famous quote by Martin Luther King Jr. that says, "Darkness cannot drive out darkness, only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate, only love can do that." Let's pray. Dear Lord our God, we praise you for your Son, Jesus Christ. He is Emmanuel, the hope of the people. He is the wisdom that teaches and guides us. He is the Savior of every nation. Lord our God, let your blessing come upon us as we light these candles of this Advent wreath. May the wreath and its light be a sign of Christ's promise to bring us salvation. May he come quickly and not delay. We ask this through your Son's name. Amen.
Dear Lord, I think about this season, and I think about my own house with the lights flickering and the celebration of your Son, and yet I drive down the street a little bit, and there is a simple manger scene with white lights and cutouts. And I think about the poem, Lord, that I just read, and I think about how you, the person that made this whole world, with your hands you made it, decided to come to earth as a baby. We thank you for Christmas, Lord. We thank you for rebirth. We thank you for the freshness that it brings. We thank you for celebration lights in the middle of a cold winter. We thank you for our friends that we celebrate with each week, Lord. Give the leaders of our church wisdom as they continue to look for a pastor and deal with a virus. And Lord, we just ask you, we invite you into the service this morning so that we can all celebrate this time, this Christmas time together with joyful hearts. And we ask it all in your name, amen. So please rise and join me as we sing Angels We Have Heard on High, or as my friend Gary one time said in the choir, it's the eggshells song. Oh goodness, I made a mistake. We'll sing and then we'll do the video, okay? All right.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains and the mountains in reply, echo back their joyous strains. Shall seize day, oh.
All right, have a seat.
Oh, sorry.
They waited too long. I guess there was another verse. Have a seat. Enjoy the next video. It's called Away in a Manger.
Asleep on the hay.
Well, I'm full of mistakes today. I think I made two so far. Hope this mic stand stays up. They say never to go after children, and I've just done that, so to myself. This song is special to me. I think it's more special to Bob. He makes me sing it every year. And whenever we practice it the first time, I had a couple of different variations, and Bob said, David, just sing it like you're singing it to a baby. And so that's kind of what we did, and that's kind of how I'm going to sing it. So I hope you enjoy this year's version of Sweet Little Jesus Boy.
Sweet little Jesus Boy, they made you be born in a manger. Sweet child, and we didn't know who you were, didn't know you'd come to save us, Lord, to take our sins away. Our eyes were blind, we could not see. Didn't know who you were. You have shown us how we are a trying master. You have shown us how it just seems like we can't do right. Look how we treated you. So please, sir, forgive us, Lord. We didn't know.
Okay, would you like to rise again and sing? Let's do so. Mary, Did You Know is what we'll sing next. Amen. You can sit down and let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you again for being here this morning. Lord, we also want to thank you for the gifts of our tithes and offerings, Lord. We thank you for giving us such a beautiful place to worship. We thank you for the flowers and the trees and the poinsettias the people have placed before us in celebration of things in their life. Lord, again, we thank you for Christmas and we thank you for the gifts and we ask it all in your name. Amen. Our last song that we're going to sing before Nancy comes up is Do You Hear What I Hear?
Said the night wind to the little lamb, Do you see what I see? Way up in the sky, little lamb, Do you see what I see? A star, dancing in the night with a tail as big as a kite. With a tail as big as a kite. Said the little lamb to the shepherd boy, Do you hear what I hear? Sky, shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear? A song, high above the trees, with a voice as big as the sea, with a voice as big as the sea. Said the shepherd boy to the mighty king, Do you know what I know? In your palace wall, mighty king, Do you know what I know? A child shivers in the cold. what I say. Pray for peace, people everywhere. Listen to what I say. The child sleeping in the night, he will bring us goodness and light. He will bring us goodness and light.
Thank you, gentlemen. Now you can rest, you merry gentlemen. Good morning. That song, Do You Hear What I Hear? It was written in 1962. How many of you, no, don't raise your hand. By Noel Regney, and music was written by Gloria Shane. They wrote it as a plea for peace during the Cuban Missile Crisis. Regney had been invited to record this song, but he was hesitant due to the commercialization of Christmas. This song has sold tens of millions of copies and has been sung, it has been covered by hundreds of artists. How many of you remember some of these artists? Eddie Fisher, Andy Williams, Pat Boone, Kate Smith, Jim Nabors, Perry Como, Robert Goulet, Mahalia Jackson, Johnny Mathis, Gladys Knight and the Pips, The Carpenters, Whitney Houston, Anne Murray, Vince Gill, Bob Hope, John Tesh, Glenn Campbell, Patti LaBelle, the United States Air Force Symphony Orchestra, Kenny G, Larry Norman, Third Day, Alicia Keys with Elmo. Now we're getting to this. We started over in this crowd. Now we're kind of moving into this crowd. Elmo, Carrie Underwood, Johnny Cash, Bob Dylan, Susan Boyle of Britain's Idol fame, and Pentatonix. Said the king to the people everywhere, listen to what I say. Pray for peace, people everywhere. Listen to what I say. The child, sleeping in the night, he will bring us goodness and light. He will bring us goodness and light. Let us pray. Father God, thank you so much for this blessing that we can gather together in your name. How precious is the time that brothers can live together in peace. It is like oil flowing down on the priest Aaron's beard, down all over his robes. How precious it is, Lord, to us that we can meet together and praise your name. Be with us, Lord, as we study your word and look into your heart at this time of Christmas. Amen. Do you see what I see? Goodness and light. Now, the fourth sense that we're studying, we're doing the five senses of Christmas. The fourth one is obviously sight. And I'd like for us to take a look at the prophet Isaiah. He was a prophet, but another name for prophet was seer. A seer was someone who could see God's will for the nation or for people. He could advise kings on decisions of national military campaigns. He could warn nations when they started to fall away from faith only in God. A seer spoke God's message to the people. The scripture that Chris read this morning from Isaiah tells us that there was a great darkness coming. Darkness, in this sense, means that there is a very low level of sight. It wasn't total blackout, right? I mean, you've been in those situations when there's nothing, you can't see your... No, it wasn't quite, but it wasn't as bright as it needed to be. Isaiah is speaking in a metaphor. He's describing the spiritual condition of the people. It's not about the ability to see with your eyes. It's about the lack of spiritual sight or discernment or awareness for the things of God. Isaiah is saying that there is little awareness of God. People might have felt like there was a spiritual fog that had set in, it put a gloom over everything. Idol worship and foreign gods were added to their worship. They had altars, like for God, right? And they put idols on top of them to make them prettier or to make them more powerful or to make them something more. But by trying to add something more, they were taking away from the power of God. And yet, there were people in this area that were still true to God. They had a little bit of light, but for the whole nation, they were judged on their corporate spirituality. Everyone in Israel faced judgment and discipline for the behaviors of the whole group, the whole nation. And we know that the judgment for being unfaithful to God, and Israel wasn't just unfaithful to God, they were grossly unfaithful to God. They were sinning, and the wages of sin is death. Isaiah was warning Israel that a time of distress and gloom and oppression was coming. But, you know, before we dive too deep into this scripture in Isaiah, I want to ask, why do we read this passage at Christmas time? Right? I mean, this was a prophecy for Israel, for those northern tribes. Yeah, but it was also a prophecy of Messiah. Messiah's coming. It foretells not only this darkness and gloom, but a time of honor and of light. So let's look at this. Isaiah 9. First, Isaiah is saying, nevertheless, there will be, okay, that gives us a clue. He's a prophet. Okay, so here's my timeline, okay? I get turned around doing my directions. Here's us, here's Isaiah, okay? Thousands of years in the past. So we're going to take Isaiah's time, and we're going to look at this, okay? Now, he's a prophet, and he says, there will be, in other words, in the future. So he's talking in the future, there will be no more gloom for those who were, past tense, in distress. So here's Isaiah. He's talking about a future time when they can look back and say, there was distress at this time, but there will be no more gloom. Okay, so you have all your time warping done. You know where we're at? In the past, he humbled this land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. Zebulun and Naphtali were two sons of Jacob. Jacob's name turned to Israel, two sons of Israel, two tribes of Israel. But in the future, he will honor Galilee of the nations by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan. This next verse, you see how the indentation's different? That gives you a clue. And if you're reading in your Bibles and you notice that the indentation is kind of offset like this, that means it's poetry. It's no longer just a story, not just narrative, not instruction. This is poetry. And as Dave gave us a poem this morning, we understand poetry is a different type of literature. Poets use different tools to help illustrate what their meaning is. The purpose of poetry isn't necessarily to create a rule or to instruct you in accurate history or those kinds of things. It's to elicit an emotion from you. That's what poetry is for. That's why Dave tries to woo his wife. I'm so sorry. I really am sorry. Not to you, Dave, but to your wife. The purpose of poetry is to get an emotion. So Isaiah is looking for this emotion. See if you can figure out what it is. People walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. What is he trying to convey? What emotion is he trying to convey here? Hope, right? These people who are in darkness, these people who are walking in darkness and deep darkness and gloom and all of this terrible stuff and distress, there is hope. And that is what he's saying here. So I'm curious as I look at these two verses, what does it mean that these tribes of Zebulun and Naphtali were humbled? Why were the people in distress? And what is this way of the sea? Why were people living in darkness? And what is this light that has dawned? When you read the Bible, I would encourage you, even in your own studies, ask yourself questions. Look at it and say, well, I don't understand that. Why would someone want to do that? And then with your questions, go dig for the answers. Look in commentaries, look in other translations, find other passages in the Bible that relate to this. Cover this in prayer. Ask God to reveal it to you. And then, if you're still wondering, give me a call. Or give the elders a call. Or give your teachers a call. Because we would love to work with you and struggle with you through these passages. Not that we all have the answers, but we'd like to learn more of the Word of God. Here are some of these answers that I've found. I've already told you that Zebulun and Naphtali were the first tribes in that northern kingdom. They were deported to Assyria. The Assyrians came 700 years before Jesus was born, and just a few years after Isaiah died, they came in and they totally wiped out all of the northern kingdom. But small groups of Jews had been left to tend the land. And then the Assyrians brought in all other kinds of peoples from all the other lands that they conquered to help fill in the gaps, to tend the land. And this conglomeration of people and religions and cultures all formed what we now know as Samaritans. This land was along a major highway from Assyria. I'm sorry, Assyria's over here for you. Assyria through Israel to the Mediterranean Sea. It's this major route through there. And it goes from Assyria all the way through Israel and then down along the Mediterranean coast the whole way to Egypt. And this road was called the Way of the Sea. Okay, so now we know what that is. Armies would take this route, going from Assyria to various places along the Mediterranean. And as these armies would pass through this northern area, they would be hungry. What do they eat? Well, there's a farm. Let's slaughter their cattle and take their grain because it's there. And they can do it. And the Israelites had no defenses. Now, can you imagine living in that time? I mean, no other nation cared about Israel enough to come to their aid, right? And they were afraid of the Assyrians, so they're not going to stop them. So these poor farmers, I mean, they would work hard. You all work hard, right? And at the end of the day, here's their crops. They harvest their crops. The army comes in, and they take all of the harvest. All of your work is just gone. Right? And your sons, if that wasn't bad enough, your sons are now conscripted into the army because the army felt they needed water carriers or they needed some slave boy to go do something for them. Anything was free for the taking. No one came to their aid. Now, what would you do if you lived in one of these tribes and you were constantly being oppressed by all of these outside forces? Well, you have choices. You could flee from this oppression. You could take the way of the sea and go someplace else. You could leave your home, or you could choose to stay there and live under this constant oppression, this darkness. And so you think, I'm stuck between two really bad choices. I don't want to leave my home. This is our land. This was my father's land. This was my grandfather's land. This is the land, you know, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years before was given to my tribe and my clan. I don't want to leave it. But on the other hand, living here is making everybody miserable, if they're even alive. They're killing off all of the people. So you're faced with this terrible decision, but it's not an either-or decision. Satan would like you to think that you get stuck between either-or decisions, but it's not the truth, because God is providing you with a third option. God provided this third option of hope. He is offering them hope. Isaiah told them that God brings hope. God brings them light. The prophecy was partly fulfilled when Hezekiah became king. He was a great leader who mostly listened to God. And he made some good reforms. And for a while, the land had a certain amount of peace. But he did not become that great king that Isaiah had told them would come. People had to wait for that great king, the one who would save them from constant oppression, the one to bring them goodness and light, whose reign would last forever. Now, we're going to take Isaiah, and we're going to jump forward. Is it this way? Yeah. Forward this way, 700 years. And we find in the Gospel of Matthew that John the Baptist has been put in prison, and he has been preaching that this great king is coming. He's preparing the way for Isaiah's prophecy to be fulfilled. Matthew 4, verses 7 through 12. And then Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, and he withdrew to Galilee, leaving Nazareth. Wait a minute, where is it? Nazareth is over here. He went and lived over in Capernaum, which is right along the lake of Galilee, right along this way of the sea. So he went from Nazareth to Capernaum, next to the Sea of Galilee, in the area of Zebulun and Naphtali, to fulfill what was said through the prophet Isaiah, the land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people living in great darkness have seen a great light. And on those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. And from that time on, Jesus began to preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." We see that Jesus fulfilled Isaiah's prophecy. He became the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. His reign will last forever because he is the Messiah. He is the chosen one. And so we celebrate Christmas. That night, the birth of a child in a stable in a small town of Bethlehem. I'm glad that Dave sang that song as if to singing it to a baby. Because I want to ask you to use your imaginations now. Imagine what Mary saw that night. I mean, the world was very busy. It was a very busy place. People were traveling, going from their hometowns to wherever they needed to go to be taxed by Caesar. And Mary was one of those people. There was so much hustle and bustle, everybody busy. Fear of the Roman oppression was stressing people out. There were so many travelers that Mary and Joseph had to spend the night in the stable. And there, Mary gives birth to Jesus. But nobody really notices at first. I mean, nobody really cares. And it's not that people weren't interested in God. It's just that to most people, a poor couple in a stable have nothing to do with God. The world hasn't really changed that much, has it? I mean, it's still a hustling and bustling place. People are busy. People are traveling. Everyone's so tied up with so many different things they have to get done before Christmas. Fear of COVID is stressing everyone out. But that doesn't mean that people aren't interested in God. I mean, no matter how busy you are, deep down, no matter how fearful you are, deep down, there is a desire to look into the heart of God. I mean, that's why there's so many religions out there. People are speculating, you know, trying to guess what's in the heart of God. There is a growing interest in spirituality. Tons of spiritual books will be under Christmas trees of many people this year. But no matter how busy we are, we all long to be touched by an angel, to look into the heart of God, to experience God. But for most, it seems, the search is unsuccessful. The spiritual book they have might be interesting, but it might not really give them the answer, or might give them the wrong answer. The latest religion was okay, but kind of confusing after a while. Some religions are even abusive. The latest shows on TV or Netflix are nice and heartwarming, but they've only caught a glimpse of God because they're good stories, and God is the creator of everything good, but it's only a glimpse, and it's not enough. And many people leave the holidays just a little down, a little disappointed. Maybe their expectations have gone unmet. They might have gotten all the toys they wanted. We talked about expectations a few weeks ago, but even though they got the things they wanted, they didn't find God. They didn't get what they were truly looking for, what they truly needed. Where do you see God? Where, when, how do you experience God? This morning, I want to walk with you through the stable on the night that Jesus was born. We're going to stand next to Mary. What did Mary see? We're talking about sight today. What did she see? Well, she sees a baby, right? But more than just a baby. She remembers the promises that God made about that baby. And she remembers and she stares into the face of this child. And she is realizing that she is staring into the heart of God. And then the shepherds arrive. And all of a sudden, there's people and loud talk and everything. They tell Mary that we saw angels. We saw angels. And the angels told us to come. And so here we are. And so they crowd into the manger. And they, too, look at the baby. And as they gaze into his face, they, too, know they are looking into the heart of God. So the shepherds eventually leave. And things get quiet. And Mary, the scriptures tell us that she ponders these things in her heart. Everything her world needs is right here. Everything that her fearful, hustling, and bustling world needs is right here. And then Mary lifts the baby up out of the manger and gives him to you. How when's the last time you held a newborn less than a day old? Well, some of you have, but for most of us, it's been a while. And so there you are, you know, you're holding this newborn baby in your arms, and it's kind of awkward at first because it's a newborn and you got to support its head and you're afraid you might drop him or do something, and it's the Son of God. But after a few minutes, your shoulders relax a bit, and he's a baby, and he's beautiful. And then you look into his face, and you too realize you're looking into the heart of God. While the rest of the world is all stressed out, running from one spiritual guru to the next, and channel surfing from one Christmas special to the next, while the rest of the world is reading all kinds of self-help books, and singing about chestnuts and snowflakes, looking for meaning and joy and God, here you are in this quiet place, away from all of that, just looking into the face of God, looking at this child, Emmanuel, God with us. Why would the Almighty God do this? The great I am. Why would he come to earth and squeeze himself into this little 7-pound baby, vulnerable and small and fragile? Why would God do that? And as you look outside the stable that night, you see a shadow. And it's a bright night out. There's lots of stars, one particularly shining bright. And you see in the shadows a cross. Then you understand, and you know. You know that someday God will sink even lower than on this night. I mean, this night he sinks from Almighty God to this fragile little human baby, human flesh, but someday God will sink even lower, beaten, naked, and hanging on a cross and dying for us. His love for you is so great. He came to earth to be with you, to love you, to care for you, and then to die for you. And you can't help but feel a little sad as you look into the face of this child, knowing how he's going to die. But you can't also help feel a little glad because you know that after this, that after the child dies, he's raised back up to life. And you know that this child you're holding is going to grow up to set the world free from sin. And so you smile because you know that it is this baby as he grows up, it's because of him that everything you've done wrong, every mistake you've made, every sin you've made can be forgiven. All of that can be taken away. You're forgiven because of this baby. You know that God loves you and offers you eternal life. So it's time to give this baby back to Mary. But before you walk away from the stable, you take one last look. and you see God's love for you, his mercy, his kindness, his wisdom. Today, God has shown you something you can call your own. If you accept Jesus Christ as your Messiah, as your King, as your Lord and your Savior, he lives in you. Yeah, you had to give the baby back to its mom, but Jesus Christ lives in you. And you can rejoice because you know that God is not a God who's off someplace far away or way back in history, in all of those stories in the Bible. He's a God here with us now, in our midst, in our hearts. You don't have to drift and wander down endless paths looking for God, looking for meaning for life. God has come looking for you. He sees you, and he has found you, even in a stable. As we leave the stable, ponder these things in your heart. I mean, the innkeeper, he saw a need, but he didn't see a king. Otherwise, he wouldn't have put him in the stable. The shepherds, they saw angels, and so they went to see this king. Mary, she saw a baby who was a miracle and who holds the promise of God. What do you see? Enjoy the holidays. Enjoy the hustle and bustle. And you know why you can enjoy it? Because you don't have to find deep meaning in all of those things. All the gifts, the gatherings, they are just simply blessings that God has given us to enjoy. So enjoy them. Enjoy one another as safely as you can. And rejoice, because apart from all of those things, we have found God and meaning and purpose and joy. We've held the baby Jesus in our arms. We have looked into the face of Christ, and we have seen the heart of God. Amen. Father God, thank you. Thank you for this time together that we can experience Christ in our lives. Lord, help us to see a king, a child, and a Savior. Amen.
Can you see Christmas through Nancy's message? Amen? Yeah, that was a nice message, Nancy. Thank you so much for helping us to see Christmas. So as you rise and sing with me, we're going to sing the first Noel, and think about that first Christmas as we sing the words of this song. So please rise and join me as we sing the first Noel.
remind you that if you have business in the lobby by the mailboxes, just to sit and wait a few minutes and let those leave who don't need to do business out there, so that they don't have to go through a crowd of people. And when you are out there, please be mindful of distancing with one another. We want to keep you all safe. We want to all see you back here next week, especially Christmas Eve, if you're able to. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you so much for your message today, for this gathering today. Thank you, Lord, for being in our presence, for being Emmanuel to us. Send us out this week, Lord, with the joy of Christmas in our hearts, that we have known and experienced Christ in us, and we can share that with one another. Bless your people, Lord. We pray this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.